office, we do comparisons on prints, we do cell phones.
August 17, 2014, did you respond to 1582 Goodrick Drive?
Yes.
Do you recall the approximate time you responded to that location?
I refer to my notes.
If that would refresh your recollection.
Yes.
Go ahead.
At approximately 8:50 is when we arrived.
Did you go to the scene by yourself or with another evidence technician?
Another evidence technician.
And who is that?
Kevin Thompson.
When you responded to the scene, who did you make contact with?
There were several officers there. My primary officer was Detective Adams.
Now, when you say primary officer, what do you mean?
He was my scene detective.
You could just describe, as an evidence technician, how it works with a scene detective as you're going through a scene.
Actually, he will direct us what he wants done. We'll take overalls of the scene, and then if he finds something of importance or feels like it's important, we'll do close-ups of it. If there's shoe tracks, he'll point out shoe tracks or any evidence that he wants processed.
Now, when you're taking these photographs, do you do that on your initial walkthrough, or you do a complete walkthrough and then seize items? How does it work?
We'll have someone kind of give us a little detail of what happened, and then we're going to take overalls first.
Location 1582 Goodrick Drive, you recall taking overall photographs of the BNSF shop?
Yes.
Following taking those overall photos, did you then enter the shop?
Yes.
Did you go in by yourself or with your primary detective?
With the primary detective and also my partner.
Now, did you photograph the entirety of the shop?
Yes.
Please.
Equals 2 marked for identification.
Your Honor, if I may approach the witness.
Yes.
Ms. Moore, showing you what's been marked as Equals 2, you recognize that CD?
Yes.
Have you, prior to today, had an occasion to review that CD?
Yes.
Okay, and the contents of the CD are what?
From scene 1.
Who took the photographs contained on the CD?
I did.
There is a signature on the CD, Peoples 2. Do you recognize that?
Yes.
Whose is it?
My signature with the date.
Your Honor, we request Peoples 2 be moved into evidence at this time, be allowed to publish.
Mr. Terry?
Submitted.
To be admitted. Proceed, Mr. Smith.
just more drawing your attention. You can see up on the upper left corner where it says JMM. What does that signify?
That's my initials.
And then the number that's subsequent to that, 6927. What does that signify?
Just the number of the photograph that I was taking.
Okay. As I go through the photographs, I'm going to reference each photograph by that signifier.
Okay.
Beginning with JMM6927, if you could just describe the photograph and what you're taking a picture of.
It's an overall of the parking area. I'm sorry, it's also like a driveway. It's a parking area on one side. It's also a driveway.
Drawing your attention now, JMM6930. If you could describe that photograph, please.
The parking area and the driveway.
There is an open door where you're able to see a light in that photograph. What is that location?
I'm not sure if that's the building, but it has the tape around it, so I believe that's the building that we entered.
JMM6932.
Okay, that's 6D, building number 6D.
Six nine six zero.
Just the front of the building.
6962.
That's the interior of the building at 6D.
6963.
Interior of the building of 6D.
6964.
The interior of the building of 6D.
6965.
The interior of the building of 6D, and then that's the open door.
6966.
The interior of the building in front of the BNSF truck.
6967.
The interior of the building looking back towards the open door.
6968.
In front of the BNSF truck, the interior of the building.
Down on the ground, there's some white items. Were you able to ascertain what that is?
Yes.
What was it?
There was a light above that had dropped down onto the ground.
Did you observe any footprints or what might be a footprint through that white items that we see on 6968?
I don't recall. If there was a shoe track, we would have photographed it. That looks like the area between, but I'm not positive. It looks like the area between the bathroom and the office. And then that would be the back door.
6970.
That was the office, and that was inside on the south end of the big shop. It was actually the southeast end.
6972.
The office.
6973.
The office.
Now, other than the cabinet here where items are strewn on the ground and the south desk of that office, were any other items askew in the room?
I don't remember.
Six, nine, seven, four.
The office.
Now, the items that were pulled out of the drawer, do you recall what they were? Primarily paper?
Papers, but I don't know what kind of papers.
6977.
It's hard to say from here, but from here it looks like it might be a fragment bullet.
Zooming in. Yeah. 6977.
Yes, a bullet.
Where was that bullet located at?
It was in the big shop, and I probably have an overall showing where it was located.
6983.
That's the front of the BNSF truck, and then that's the light that had fallen down, the white mark that you see across.
7001.
And that's the light that had fallen.
7011.
It's a cell phone.
Did you seize that cell phone?
Item number 10. Can I refer to my notes?
That would refresh your recollection. Court's permission.
Thank you. Yes.
What is item 10?
Item number 10 is a flip phone, Samsung.
Is there any numbers that come with that flip phone?
There's a neat hex number, and do you want me to read that off?
Yes.
Okay, it's A, and then 00000. 4403 CCF3.
What is the model of that phone?
The model is SCH-U660.
Recall where this phone was located at?
I don't remember where it was at. I'll have I think it was in the office, but I have a photograph that will show.
Photo 7012.
That's showing the blood and also evidence number 8.
And what is evidence number 8?
The blood, and I'm not sure where it is. Okay, that was on the interior of the refrigerator door.
Now, where was that in respect to Robert Lamone's body?
He was on the driver's side of the BNSF truck, and the door was open and on the driver's side of the BNSF truck. It was just closer to the front of the truck.
Photos turned, but 7013.
It's another photo of the interior of the refrigerator door.
Did you recall seeing any blood to the exterior of the door, or did you only see it on the interior?
I don't remember.
7013 as well, but photograph 7033.
That's the interior of the truck.
Is that 7036 also the interior of the vehicle?
Yes, from the driver's side.
Lastly, item photograph JMM 7042. What is that a photograph of?
That is the bag that they put the body in.
There is a blue tag that is with body bag. Can you see that from there?
Yes.
Okay, what is that blue tag for?
A seal.
In relation to that tag, blue tag number 27171, were you present when Mr. Lamone's body was placed in the bag August 17, 2014?
Yes.
Were you also present at the autopsy of Robert Lamone?
Yes.
Now, at the autopsy of Robert Lamone, was the bag still sealed with the blue tag 27171? date of that autopsy was August 20th, 2014?
Yes.
You said that the primary detective will kind of direct your attention, things to do. Do you recall if you took photographs of any shoe prints?
Are we still talking about scene one?
Yes.
Yes.
What were the ground conditions like around the shop at the NSF?
There was a lot of cement, and I think the shoe tracks that we took were in the back of the shop, and that was dirt.
Did you attempt to get any latent prints while in the BNSF shop at scene one?
Yes.
Where did you do that at?
We processed the two vehicles that were in the shop. We processed the office for prints.
Starting with the office, did you locate any usable prints?
No.
Now, when you don't locate a usable print, what does that mean?
There might be smudges, but they're insufficient for comparison.
You said that you attempted to get latent prints from both vehicles that were in the shop.
Yes.
Starting with the Honda, were you able to get any usable prints from the Honda?
Yes.
Moving on to the BNSF work truck, were you able to get any usable prints from that truck?
Yes.
And when you do find usable prints, what do you do to kind of keep them for later comparison?
What we do is we use a graphite powder and we'll dust the object, and then we lift it with lifter tape, and then we'll put it on a white card, and we write the date, and then we'll also put where we got the latent print from, and then our initials at the bottom, or our name at the bottom.
Now, as part of the further investigation, did you go and get some latent prints from individuals that worked at BNSF to do the comparison?
Yes.
Okay, who did you get latents from?
Okay, there were 9 subjects. Do you want me to spell the names?
You can just provide them.
Okay, Corey Hamilton, Samantha Hamilton, Sean Ware, Ashley Ware, John Justice, and that's J-U-S-T-U-S, Aaron Galindo, Dennis Stankovich, Ryan Galindo, and Nicholas Denny.
Now, these latent prints that you recovered, did you compare them to the individuals you just provided the names for?
Yes.
Were you able to make any matches, or able to locate any particular individual's fingerprints on the doors of either of the vehicles?
Yes.
What did you find?
It was Corey Hamilton out of the 9 subjects' names that I just read.
And where were his fingerprints?
Corey Hamilton's was on lifter number 22, the exterior driver's door. And it was his left index finger. And he was also on lifter number 26, the exterior of the right front passenger door. And it was his right palm.
And that was the BNSF work truck?
Yes.
Do you recall when, the 9 names you just given, do you recall when you got those latent prints?
The ink prints?
Yes.
Oh, okay. The ink prints were taken on 8/20 of 2014.
And where were you at when you got the latents?
At the Tehachapi substation.
So in essence, all those people showed up, rolled their fingerprints, put them into the system.
Well, they're not put into the system, but came to the office, to the substation, and we rolled their prints, and then we did a comparison So they're just elimination prints. They don't go into a system.
When you were doing the comparison, did you have Jonathan Hearn's fingerprints to compare?
No.
Now, were you present, or were you able at some point to roll the latents for Jonathan Hearn?
Yes.
When?
On 11/18/2014.
On that same day, did you also fingerprint Sabrina Lamont?
Yes.
Terry Croft?
Yes. Good afternoon, Ms. Moore.
Hello.
Ms. Moore, you collected a number of items of evidence from the scene. On Goodrick, is that correct?
Yes.
And some of the items were cell phones?
Yes.
Was there more than one cell phone that was actually recovered?
Let me check. Okay, number 9 was a black Motorola cell phone, and number 10, a black Samsung flip phone.
Now, the black Motorola, that was a Droid Razor, is that right?
I don't know. I have a model number.
XT907?
Yes.
Okay. And did you actually do, as you mentioned, you do extractions of phones, is that right?
Yes.
Did you actually do an extraction from that razor, Motorola razor, Model XT907?
No.
Do you know if someone did?
I don't know. I only have my reports.
Okay.
So someone else may have done it.
Who else besides yourself was doing the extractions on the cell phones that were recovered?
Kevin Thompson does cell phones, and also at the time, and he's since retired, Jeff Slayton.
I may show you what's been marked as Defense Exhibit A. Recognize that report?
There's no name on it.
Okay. Is there any way to tell who did the extraction if you didn't?
There would be a service request done.
But you don't recall doing the extraction on that particular cell phone, is that correct?
No.
You say there had been a request done to do the extraction?
Oh, I don't know if there has. If there was, there would be a service request.
Well, that's my question. There would be a request done to do the extraction if it had been requested, is that right?
Yes.
And who would normally be the one requesting those extractions to be done?
It could be the detective or the district attorney.
Now you indicated that you took, you found some usable prints at the scene, is that right?
Yes.
Okay. And you compared those to what would be considered normally possible elimination prints, is that right?
Yes.
Okay, those were the initial prints you took, would that be accurate?
Are we talking about the latent prints or the elimination prints?
The elimination prints.
We didn't take them that day, we took them, I think, 3 days later.
Gather the prints at the scene, the latent, right?
Yes. You
basically use the fingerprint powder, which is usually a black powder that you use, right?
Yes, graphite powder.
Okay. You lift them and put them on a card, right?
Yes.
Then, at some point, you obtain the elimination prints from persons who may work there. Is that what you did?
Yes.
And then you compared the elimination prints to the latent prints, is that right?
Yes.
Okay. In this case, were you able to identify the latents to any of the prints that were the elimination prints?
Yes.
Okay. How many of the latents that you recovered were you able to identify as being from the elimination prints?
Two prints.
How many latents totally did you obtain?
Let me check. There were 12 prints.
And with regards to the elimination prints that you identified, do you recall what individuals they were that you were able to attribute those latents to?
The elimination of the 9 people, the only person it came back on was Corey Hamilton.
Were there any prints that could be attributed to Sabrina Limon that you located based upon obtaining a print card for them and comparing them to the latents?
No.
Were there any of the latent prints that they match with Jonathan Hearn?
No.
Did any of the prints match up to Robert Malone?
Yes.
Which ones?
Robert Malone, he was latent print number 18 on the interior driver's door by his right palm, and also latent number 21, the exterior driver's door by his left index. And then there was lifter number 27, and that was the top of the vehicle above driver's window, and that was his left middle.
Nothing further. Terry, based on that question and answer, anything, sir?
Nothing further, Your Honor.
Just step down now. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Smith?
People call it detective Adams.
Could you step up to the podium, raise your right hand, be sworn?
You solemnly state the testimony you shall give in this matter shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth shall be God.
I do.
Come on up, have a seat, please, sir. Good afternoon. Can you tell us your name and spell your last name for the record?
Mitchell Adams, A-D-A-M-S.
Your witness, Mr. Smith.
How are you currently employed?
I'm a detective with the Kern County Sheriff's Office.
How long have you worked for the Kern County Sheriff's Office?
20 years.
You also signed as a detective in August of 2014?
Yes.
Did you receive a call out on August 17, 2014, about 7:18 in the evening?
I did.
Do you recall where you responded to?
It was an industrial area in Tatchby.
Recall what time you arrived?
I don't know the specific time.
Now, when you did arrive, what were your initial observations?
I was assigned to process the scene. So I met with other detectives for a brief.
When you process a scene, just describe what you're doing as a detective.
Basically, gathering evidence, collecting evidence, assuring that photographs get taken, processing for DNA, taking swabs.
Who were you working with that evening?
I believe technical investigators Thompson and Moore.
And when you arrived, did you observe that the area was cordoned off, the perimeter?
Yes.
Did you observe whether there was an inner and outer perimeter, or just one?
There was both an inner and an outer.
Were they both manned?
Yes, they were.
If you could describe the industrial complex as you remember it.
When you entered the main driveway, I believe there was a building immediately to the left or the east of the driveway, and then there were a long set of buildings along the west and the east side of the property, and each building contained numerous suites.
Now, when you were driving up to where the industrial complex was, do you remember there being a big sign that says the NSF?
Once I made it to the actual location, I remember seeing a sign, yes.
What did you see?
Just a BNSF sign on the side of the building.
How big was it?
I don't know. It was fairly large, I would say.
Did you see any other markings?
Not that I recall, no.
Okay. Do you remember if this was on the left or right side of the building?
This would have been on the west side of the building.
See any other markings on the building where the shop was located?
None that I recall.
Did you receive a briefing?
Yes.
From whom?
I believe it was Senior Deputy Moncur.
When you entered the process of seeing, what were you looking for? Anything specific?
Nothing specific. It just whatever presents itself at the time.
Now, did you request a search warrant for that location?
Yes.
Do you recall who you requested author a search warrant?
Detective Kimmel.
Did you recall approximately when you made the request for the search warrant to be offered?
I don't recall the times, no.
Recall how long you had to wait for the search warrant?
I would estimate probably an hour and a half, maybe 2 hours.
Now, after you received word the search warrant had been authored and signed, what did you do?
That time we actually entered the suite.
When you say we, what are we talking about?
Myself and the technical investigators.
Did you assign duties to the technical investigators?
Throughout the course of the investigation, yes.
Starting with technical investigator Thompson, what was his duties?
I believe I had him videotape the entire scene. And he may have photographed shoe tracks on the outside of the building.
Technical investigator Moore, what were her duties?
She assisted mostly with the interior. I know she took swabs and collected some glass and possibly a bullet or a fragment.
Let's start with the exterior of the building. What did you see that you found to be significant that you directed the technical investigators to?
On the back side of the building, I know we located at least one shoe track.
Did you direct them to take photographs of the shoe print?
Yes.
On the exterior of the building, did you locate anything else?
With the exception of shoe tracks, I don't believe we located anything.
The dirt conditions like? Hard pan?
Is it sandy? Most of it was very hard pack.
Now, when you entered into the shop, what were your initial observations?
When we started walking through the shop, I walked between two vehicles, a BNSF work truck on the left, and a small Honda car on the right. We walked through between the two of those and located where a fluorescent bulb had fallen to the ground in front of the BNSF truck. When we continued through there and turned to the right, which would have been into the office area, there were drawers open and items strewn about the interior of the office.
Looking back to where the light fixture was, did you look to see where the light came from?
Yes, when I looked up to the fixture, I looked, there was a place for two bulbs. One of the bulbs was missing.
Did you see any damage to the light fixture?
It looked like there was some kind of a small minor damage to the interior of the light fixture.
The large amount of glass to the front of the truck. Did you see if there was any footprints through the glass or what could be shoe prints?
I don't recall seeing any shoe tracks throughout the glass, no.
You said after went through that area, you went to the office.
Yes.
You could describe again your observations there.
Well, there were two desks on the west wall in the office, and there were numerous items that I assume were from the desks strewn about the interior of the office.
Did you look to see what type of items were strewn about the office?
I believe it was mostly file folders and several binders.
Now, as a detective, what did you think when you looked to see a bunch of file folders and binders strewn about an office?
The way that the binders and the paperwork presented that day, it struck me as odd, the placement of things, the amount of things. I immediately started thinking that it was possibly a staged scene.
Why did you think that?
In numerous investigations that I've conducted with burglaries, robberies, and such, I've never seen items placed as those were, and the amount of items.
Now, this impression that you had, did you talk about that with other detectives on scene?
I did.
Do you recall who you spoke with about that impression that you just testified about?
I would assume it would have been Detective Kimmel.
Speaking with Detective Meyer and about your impressions?
I may have.
You also talked that you observed and expended what you believe to be a bullet in that same shot?
Yes, I did.
And where did you see the expended bullet at?
It was on the east side of the shop between the office and the restroom area in front of the BNSF truck.
You say expended bullet. Describe what you saw.
Just the projectile portion.
Where was the projectile in relation to where Robert Lamont was?
I would say it was approximately 15 to 20 feet east, southeast of him.
Where was the projectile in relation to where the light fixture that had been damaged was at?
I would say almost directly below.
Then go towards the area of the BNSF work truck within the shop.
Yes.
Can you describe your observations at that location?
We walked the same way back between the two vehicles towards the western portion of the shop, turned north around the backside of the BNSF truck, and started walking along the driver's side of the truck when we located a deceased male body.
Walking around the vehicle, saw Robert there. Was it late in the evening?
I would imagine it was midnight or around there.
Now, when Robert's body was initially found, it was approximately 6 in the evening. What's the reason for leaving him at that location until your search is complete?
I don't want to rush into the scene and disturb or damage any evidence that lies between the entrance and where the actual body is located.
Technical investigator Moore testified that she was present when Robert's body was placed into a body bag.
Yes.
Does that occur after you're done with your search or before?
Depending on the circumstances, each case is different. In this particular case, I believe it was after the search was completed.
And why did you decide to do that?
There was a lot of evidence.
Going back to where you saw Robert Lamont lying on the ground, what were your observations about him, the refrigerator, and the items around him?
He was laying face up between the truck and the small refrigerator. The refrigerator door was open. It looked like items that had been in the refrigerator were now outside of the refrigerator. But there was some blood spatter inside the refrigerator. And he had his left arm across his chest and his right arm out to the side at about a 45-degree angle towards his head.
Now, as Robert lay there, did you sense anything significant in how he was positioned?
Nothing, no.
Okay, what about the beverages that were near him on the ground?
Other than they appeared to come out of the refrigerator, no.
About the blood?
The blood was around his body coagulated.
What about the blood you observed on the refrigerator?
Small amount of spatter.
Now the blood that was on the refrigerator, was it at the top of the door or the bottom of the door?
As I recall, it was in the bottom right portion.
Is that significant to you at all?
It can tend to give a direction from which way the blood came.
What information did you, being a detective, kind of get? get from what you saw with the blood at the bottom of the refrigerator door?
From its position would be that the refrigerator door was open at the time of the injury.
Request the scene be processed for latents.
Yes.
Do you remember what particular location you made the request for?
I know the interior of the office area and portions of the BNSF truck. I believe the door handles and the push buttons for the roll-up doors were also processed.
Recall who you directed to dust for prints?
I believe it was Technical Investigator Moore.
What items of evidence were seized from near Robert Lamont's body? Either by you or by the Technical.
I would have to refer to my evidence list.
Do you have that with you?
I do.
If you could read that and refresh your recollection with the court's permission.
Go ahead.
Thank you. Okay, there was an EKG strip taken from near his body, and a black wallet with its contents was actually taken from the body of Mr. Lamont.
Again, being a detective, the fact that the wallet was not taken from the deceased, was that significant to you?
It was.
How so?
It basically tells us that this was probably not a robbery.
Release Robert Lamont's body to the coroner investigator?
Yes.
Now, when Robert was being placed into the body bag, did you see the process or did you observe what they were doing?
Yes.
Okay, what did you see?
They were placed evidence preservation bags on his hands, placed him into the body remains bag, and sealed it with a locking tag.
The purpose of the preservation bags?
To preserve any evidence that may be on the hands, under the fingernails, etc.
Now, other than what we talked about, the shoe tracks that you had photographs taken of, the expended bullet, the items near Mr. Robert Lamont's body, do you recall any other significant items of evidence?
There were swabs taken of the buttons on the roll-up door, of the doorknobs. I believe there were latent prints located on the vehicle in at least one or two places.
So let's step back to the swabs on the buttons. Did you also have them dust for prints?
I believe they dusted prior to.
So what was the purpose of taking the swabs?
Or any kind of touch DNA that may be left behind.
Did you direct any other swabs be taken for touch DNA?
That I recall offhand, I believe the refrigerator blood we swabbed, and there was also a red stain in front of the BNSF truck that I requested be swabbed.
And that red stain, why did you request that be swabbed?
At that time, I did not know what it was.
Other than the office where items were strewn about, did you see within the shop any other locations where items have been thrown down?
Within the shop itself, I don't believe so.
to Terry. Cross, yeah. Please.
Thank you. Good afternoon, Detective Adams.
Good afternoon.
Detective Adams, now you mentioned with regards to your observations as you entered that you noticed that the fluorescent light bulb had been broken. Is that right?
Correct.
And that was to the front of the truck that was parked inside the warehouse. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay. And then, based on my wonderful experience with fluorescent bulbs, it tends to leave a lot of white powder on the floor. Is that right?
Yes.
When it breaks?
Correct.
Yeah. I was told once that stuff's poison, so I'm always careful of that. Now, with regards to that, you said you saw no indication of any footprints. Is that right?
I don't recall seeing any footprints in that area.
And certainly, if you had, you would have photographed them, would you not?
Absolutely.
Okay. And you indicated that there appeared to be some type of damage to the light fixture. Is that right?
Yes.
Did you actually get a ladder and examine it or have that photographed up close?
I believe it was photographed, but the ladder, we did not have one at the time.
Okay. So you had to photograph it from the floor?
Correct. If we photographed it, it would have been from the floor.
And if I remember correctly, I think somebody said that the ceiling height in that building is about 18 feet high. Is that right?
I would agree with that, yes.
Okay. And the fixtures were hanging somewhat down from the ceiling?
Correct.
Okay. So they're probably somewhere around the range of about 15 feet or more from the floor of the building, right?
That would be fair to say.
Now, you indicated there were some footprints to the rear of the building or to the east side of the building, is that right?
Correct.
Okay. And that was in the hard pan dirt, is that right?
It would have been in the more softer dirt.
Okay. But you said that earlier you testified that the dirt was somewhat hard packed.
The majority of it was.
Okay. What's behind that building? I got to ask.
Behind the building is a field, I believe, that goes all the way to Highway 58.
Okay. I think there's a dirt road type of thing that leads into the complex from that direction also, right?
Quite possibly, yes.
What do you recall?
I don't recall, no.
Okay. Now, do you recall approximately what time it was that you actually entered this scene?
I don't recall the exact time, though.
No. Well, there's a log that's maintained by the person in charge of the crime scene log, is that right?
That indicates the time that you entered the scene and left the scene.
Okay.
Not specific detail.
Now, does this sound approximately right, that you entered the scene at approximately 21:15 hours?
I believe it was probably later than that, but I couldn't swear to that.
Crime scene log for that scene, is it not?
It is.
Okay, and that was prepared by the deputy Moncour, is that right? What time is reflected that you arrived on, actually entered the scene?
Actually entered the barricaded area at 21:15.
Okay, so it's in the barricaded area, but then you stayed outside the warehouse area until you received your search warrant?
Correct.
And by the time you arrived, I'm assuming that the medical personnel had already left the area, is that right?
I believe they had left.
Okay. Had the coroner's office arrived to remove Mr. Lamone's body at that point?
I don't believe they arrived until an hour or so after we did.
Okay. So by the time you had arrived, you already had the person, the first person who was in the building, which was the person who found Mr. Lamone, right?
Yeah, I believe he was still on scene.
Okay. And then you also had the deputies who arrived and also located him. Is that right?
Yes.
And then by the time you arrived, the medical personnel has already also been in to the scene. Is that right?
Yes.
Now, during the course of your examination of the crime scene, did you actually observe anywhere on the walls, the ceiling, what appeared to be a bullet strike?
Yes, I did.
Okay. Where was that located?
That was in the fluorescent light fixture.
The one that you didn't get a ladder to examine, is that right?
Yes.
Okay. But you thought that that was a possible bullet strike?
It appeared that it could have been, yes.
Okay. Did you actually get someone to examine it to make sure that it was, in fact, a bullet strike?
No.
Okay. And you found a, you indicated a bullet fragment on the floor, is that right?
Correct.
Okay. Now, when we're talking a bullet fragment, how much of the actual projectile are we talking about?
I believe the one located there was the majority of the projectile.
Okay. Well, was it a copper-jacketed slug? Was it a just a lead slug? Was it a steel slug?
Without seeing the photographs that were taken, I couldn't guess.
Okay. Well, you examined the crime scene, right?
Correct.
And you were the one who was directing the technical investigators to process the scene, is that right?
Yes.
And that would have been on the interior, that would have been T.I. Moore. Is that right?
Yes.
Now, you'd indicated that you observed what appeared to be blood spatter on the interior portion of the refrigerator, is that right?
Yes.
And it was on the lower portion of the door?
As I recall, the lower right, yes.
Okay. You're not an expert when it comes to ballistics and blood spatter evidence, right?
Expert, no.
You've had some training in that area, I'm certain, during your 20 years?
Yes.
Okay, but not, you wouldn't be qualified as an expert in that area, right?
No.
You also instructed T.I. Moore on the interior of the building to take swabs from certain locations for possible DNA comparison. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay. Do you recall where what locations it was that you instructed her to swab?
I recall taking the swabs of the red stain in front of the truck, the blood on the refrigerator, the knobs and the push button for the doors leading to the outside. Yes.
Okay. And when you say push button, are you talking about the remote in the truck or are you talking about a button inside the building itself?
The remote garage door that lifts up, there's a wall-mounted switch with, I believe it was three switches contained there.
Okay. We're not talking about a remote control inside the pickup. We're talking about one mounted on the wall. Is that right?
Correct.
And did you also have them swab the areas where the items, where we saw the file cabinets were open and items been strewn about?
I don't believe those were swabbed. I know they were dusted for fingerprints.
But no DNA was taken from those locations?
I don't believe so.
Now, you were asked about the fact that the wallet was still found in Mr. Lamone's possession, his body, when he was when you arrived. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay. How much money was in the wallet?
Offhand, I could not say.
You know, there's even any?
I don't know.
Well, you said that normally people who are committing robberies will take the wallet, or sometimes just take the contents, right?
Yes.
So with regards to this instance, there you can't even ascertain, or you don't recall whether or not even having money in his wallet when you were examining it?
I don't know as if I actually touched the wallet.
Well, certainly that would have, if there had been a substantial amount of cash that was remaining, then that certainly would have tipped you off that maybe this wasn't a robbery, right?
You would think so, yes.
And if there was no cash, it still could be a robbery at that point, right?
Depending on where the wallet was located.
Or where it was put back.
In my experience, generally, a suspect doesn't put the wallet back where they took it from.
Generally.
Right.
But there are exceptions, right?
Absolutely.
And certainly in this case, you had no idea whether or not it actually he'd had any money or not, because you don't recall whether
Correct.
He had cash in the wallet or not.
Correct.
Okay, thank you. Nothing further.
Mr. Smith?
Nothing further.
You step down, Detective. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Mr. Smith?
Technical investigator Thompson.
Sir, would you come forward, step up to the podium, raise your right hand and be sworn?
You do solemnly state that the testimony you shall give in this matter shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
Come on up, have a seat, please. Good afternoon, sir. Can you tell us your name and spell your last name for the record?
My name is Kevin Thompson, Thompson.
You're with us, counselor.
How are you currently employed?
I work for the Kern County Sheriff's Office.
What's your current assignment?
I'm a evidence technician assigned to technical investigations.
How long have you been an evidence technician?
20 years.
August 17, 2014, did you arrive at 1582 Goodrich Drive?
May I refer to my notes?
That refresh your recollection with the court's permission?
Go ahead.
And that was 8/17/2014?
Yes.
Yes.
Recall if you went by yourself or with another evidence technician?
My partner was Jackie Moore.
When you arrived on scene, did you also make contact with the Detective Adams?
Yes, I did.
In
the subsequent days following arriving on 8/17/2014, did you also get tasked with locating any available surveillance footage on Goodrick Drive?
I did.
Who tasked you with going to the businesses to see if you could locate surveillance footage?
Detective Meyer.
Recall which locations you went to locate surveillance footage.
On which day?
How many days did it take?
I don't recall. There were several.
Well, let's start with the 18th. Where did you go on the 18th?
It was at 1582 Goodrick.
Attorney, if I may approach, I have an item marked.
Yes.
Equals 3, mark next in order.
If I may approach the witness.
Please.
Do you recognize the aerial photographs contained in People's 3?
I do.
You recognize the location of 1582 Goodrick Drive, where you initially responded, August 17th?
Yes.
Your Honor, I would request People's 3 be moved into evidence at this time. Be allowed to publish.
Chair, any objection?
No, Your Honor.
To be admitted, you can publish, Mr. Smith. Thank you.
You stated on the 18th you went to 1582 Goodrick Drive, or just drawn a circle, is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. Where were you able to locate surveillance footage? Which cameras, if you recall?
Cameras 5 and camera 6.
Can you recall what direction those were facing?
I recall camera 5 is a south-facing from the back side of the building.
South-facing would be pointing towards the east to Hatchview Boulevard, is that correct?
Yes.
Now, on August 19th, where did you respond to get additional surveillance video?
On the 19th, we were back at that same location at 1582 Goodrick.
Why did you go on subsequent days to 1582 Goodrick to get surveillance footage?
I guess the detectives had obtained additional information and asked me to follow up.
Now, that footage, did you later provide portions of it to Detective Meyer and other detectives, showing an individual walking across the parking lot?
I provided footage to the detectives, yes.
That footage was subsequently disseminated to the media as well?
I believe so.
Do you have a copy of that, of those clips with you today?
I do not have a copy of the clips with me, although I do have some screen captures.
If I could have a copy of those, please.
I don't have a copy. I have just the originals.
One second, please, Jim. Record reflect I did have the opportunity to speak to council at sidebar. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to go ahead and take our afternoon recess now. I have everybody back at 3:15, okay? 3:15. Remember not to form or express any opinion or discuss the case. We'll see you back at 3:15.